right about now.
Hey everybody, welcome to the Right About Now podcast. Thank you so much for joining me today. This is a tough episode for me today. I will be honest with you, I've been having a very difficult week. I lost my best friend, Adam Schlesinger, to the coronavirus last week on April Fool's. Adam was born on Halloween and he died on April Fool's. It's unbelievable. For those of you who don't know who Adam Schlesinger is, Adam was the co-founder of the groups Fountains of Wayne and Ivy. He is an Emmy-winning, Grammy-winning, Oscar-nominated songwriter for film, television, and theater. Most of you have seen That Thing You Do. Well, that was Adam's song. The classic song Stacy's Mom has got it going on. That's Adam's song. Music and Lyrics, great movie with Hugh Grant, all Adam's music. The theme to Cranky Anchors, The Howard Stern Show, Stephen Colbert's Christmas Special. He co-wrote all the songs on the show Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. He is really one of these guys that was behind the scenes on so many of the songs that made us happy, that we love. So his career was incredibly prolific and enviable. Adam leaves behind a huge legacy. But to me, he was really a best friend. And I have known Adam since I was 3 months old. Our parents went to college together and we met in the crib, and the friendship lasted 52 years. And it is inexplicable and shocking and awful that somebody who meant so much to so many people should be taken from us in such a tragic way at such a young age. But this is not a podcast for me to get depressed, because honestly, Adam was probably the funniest person I've ever known in my entire life. And so to do a depressing podcast about Adam Schlesinger just seems totally off kilter, but I did want to just open up by talking about how much I missed him. And I wanted to pay tribute to him through this podcast by playing one of the first episodes I ever recorded of Right About Now, episode number 6. I journeyed over to Adam's house out here in Los Angeles. We sat in his dining room. I set up my little microphones, and just like we always do, we just sat around and talked about music and joked and laughed. And I tried to get to the bottom of how he became who he is and lessons that he could teach us. And Adam was always teaching me so much. Even subconsciously, now that I look back on his life, I realize how much I learned knowing Adam. I mean, first of all, I got to give Adam credit for this podcast in general. Adam named Right About Now. Adam was a brilliant namer of things. He loved coming up with clever names. And so when I told him I want to do a podcast, he asked a few questions, went back to his brain. And then, you know, for the next hour, I kept getting these funny texts of different names for the podcast. One of them was Small Talk, which, you know, I'm Jonathan Small, so I kind of like that one. But I said, oh no, I think it needs to be about writing. I think we need to say the word writing. And he came up with Right About Now. And I love that name. And I love that one of the many things that he leaves behind that have made my life happier and better. And people always comment about how much they love the name of this podcast. It's all Adam Schlesinger. And all throughout my life, Adam has just been there as an inspiration. I mean, Adam and I used to record music when we were 10 years old. He's the kind of person, he could sit down at the piano and just play anything by ear that he heard. He just had a natural gift. He really didn't even need to study piano. He just had a gift. My father had a similar gift. He was very, very tuned in to my father, very, very inspired by my father, who was also a composer and a songwriter. And He used to always say that my father is the reason that he is who he is, and I always really appreciated that. And he grew up with this example of somebody making money by making music and thought, well, that's how I want to live my life. And he went ahead and lived his life that way. And Adam always did what he believed he was put on this earth to do, and that's to make incredible music. And he was so good at that. From the time we were kids, we would compose little pieces. I have a cassette, which I have to find, of our first song that we wrote together, which was called Mandy, which was about his fat cat. And it was just all about how this poor little cat was so fat that he could barely move around. That was a really great song that we wrote together. And then we kind of graduated in our high school days to hip hop. And Adam and I recorded a ton of songs together. We would go down to his little studio in his basement, and we had all these little 1980s style drum machines. And Adam would always make these amazing beats. One of the best beat makers I've ever known, and these incredible bass lines and choruses. And it was just so fun to create with Adam. And we always knew Adam would be a big star. And he went on to become a big star. And there's been so many beautiful pieces written about him over the past week. One of the ones I love the most was in The New Yorker. Such a beautiful writer, guy by the name of Jody Rosen, wrote that Schlesinger's death will undoubtedly bring him greater renown than he ever knew in life. With the terrible instant clarity that tragedy confers, it's now easy to recognize him for what he was, a modest man of a modestly lavish talent. He was one of the great songwriters of his generation, with a body of work that stands next to those of far bigger, bold-faced names. Amen to that, brother. Adam was an unbelievable talent and just a truly one-of-a-kind friend. You would never be in a bad mood if you were in Adam's presence. He was just such a happy, good person that loved to bring people together of all walks of life. When Adam would invite me out to dinner, I would sometimes think, oh, good, oh, you know, nice little one-on-one time with Adam. There would be 20 people there because he loved to bring people together. And yet he would have all those people there and everybody felt like they were getting enough Adam time and all his attention. He was just so present and so fun to be around. One of the things I learned from him as an artist was that he was always so true to his own voice. Adam was authentic before that was even like a cool thing to be. He had a confidence that was so admirable. He was so sure of his art and his talent that he didn't let other people define him. And he always did what he wanted to do, the way he wanted to do it. So anyway, I'm not going to talk anymore. I'm going to let this interview do the talking. I will be completely honest with you. I started listening to this interview and it just broke me up. Could not do it. Not quite there yet. But I know when I played it, a lot of people said it was very valuable to them and fascinating, and they learned a ton, not only about Adam, but about how somebody like Adam works. And so I wanted to share it as a tribute to my best friend and somebody who I will miss tremendously, somebody who was always so supportive of me in every endeavor I did, particularly this podcast. He loved this podcast. So this is for Adam Schlesinger. I hope you enjoy it. Adam Schlesinger, welcome to Write About Now.
Thank you very much, John Small.
It's a pleasure to have you here with us today. So Adam, you're a different type of guest for me. You are a specialist in writing incredibly catchy pop tunes.
Oh, thank you.
And themes. And I've also known you my entire life, so that just makes it even more fun for me.
It's a special edition. Right About Now.
Special edition of Right About Now. So I want to talk to you about writing lyrics. As you know, I have attempted to write a few lyrics in my life, but you have written many, many lyrics. Is there like a certain formula to writing a lyric, or is it just like you sit down with the music and you just try to make it go?
Well, it really depends what I'm writing for. I mean, I do a lot of different kinds of songwriting, and some of it is just an assignment that I'm given. And that's particularly in the worlds of TV and film. The song has to be about whatever they tell me it has to be about. So it's almost more like writing pages of a script, and the music part is almost, I wouldn't say incidental, but you know, you're really just helping to tell a story. Like this show that I work on now, which is called Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, it's like a musical. It's like a Broadway show, except it's on TV. So every song in that case is really part of telling the story of the show. And that happens a lot with stuff I get assigned for films too, or whatever. Even if it's not a story in and of itself, it has to fit within the story of the movie. Like it's a fake hit song, like, you know, that kind of thing. But right. Then when I'm writing just for my own sort of art, if you will, you know, for Fountains of Wayne, my band, or Ivy, which was the other band I was in, I would sometimes just start with music and kind of start with gibberish and see what it sparked.
Do you do that? So you write like gibberish down, like you just write words down, like dibba 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 dibba.
You know, I mean, a lot of people do write like that. Like I know a lot of bands start with music and they kind of just do sounds and then that morphs into something and then they make lyrics out of it. I actually have a much easier time with music than I have with lyrics. So for me, I sometimes like to just have some kind of lyric first. You know, if I have a piece of music and no lyrics, sometimes it just never gets finished. But if I have a lyric that I like, I know that I'll figure out something musical for it eventually.
Right. So let's talk about Crazy Ex-Girlfriend for a minute. Okay. So you write, how many songs like per episode do you write for Crazy Ex-Girlfriend about?
A minimum of two. Sometimes it's been as much as four. And we're on our third season. So we just passed 100 songs for the show, which is insane.
That's crazy.
Yes.
So how much is it a collaborative effort with Rachel? How much do you do it on your own?
Yeah, it's Rachel Bloom who's created the show. She started out as a songwriter, and she did funny songs on YouTube that got her a lot of attention. So it's Rachel and it's me, and there's a third songwriter named Jack Dolgen, who's also one of the writers on the show. And at this point, we divide and conquer because it's just so much to have to write. So we split them up. Sometimes we sit in a room and just try to come up with something together from scratch. Sometimes one of us just writes the whole thing. I mean, it's case by case.
What is one that you wrote on your own?
Let's see. I wrote a song called Gettin' By. That's it's an anthem for this character that decides he's bisexual.
Right. And did you come up with the name Gettin' By?
Well, I did in that case. I mean, the writers came up with the idea that he would sing a song, sort of an anthem about announcing his bisexuality. And then they had a temp idea, which I think was Rachel's, which was called By the By, I'm By. And it was like sort of an old-timey song.
Yeah.
But I, for some reason, decided I wanted to try this kind of Huey Lewis type 80s rock song because I thought that would be the kind of song that this character Daryl might just listen to in real life. You know, he's sort of a guy that would be the right age to have Huey Lewis sports.
Yeah.
Sonically, it's kind of that. And then lyrically, I had a whole bunch of bullet points that I was sort of given of like, you know, they talk to all these like bisexual groups and stuff. So these are important points that we think.
Oh, really? So even before?
Yeah, like they were sort of like vetted in terms of like, well, what would a person, you know, what's offensive to a bisexual person and what's not offensive? What are they proud of? And
I'm curious, what is offensive?
Like things like just because you say you're bisexual doesn't mean that you're a slut, or it doesn't mean that you're undecided, or it doesn't mean that you're really gay. So they gave me all these bullet points. Like we kind of want to hit on all these things. But the funniest joke about that song is that he sings it to, he's the boss of this law firm on the show. And the real joke is that he thinks it's this big deal that he's telling everyone in his office that he's decided he's bisexual and nobody cares. Like they're all just kind of grossed out that their boss is even talking about this and they just want to stop. They just wanted to stop. So that it's funny. It's a funny video and it's a funny song, I think.
So you just sat down, you kind of had Huey, did you like go and listen to a Huey Lewis song like before you?
I had sort of the groove in my back, but with a song like that, I kind of started with lyrics and I didn't touch an instrument for a while. I just wrote down a bunch of these joke ideas and rhymes, and I wanted to be very rhymey.
Yeah,
you know. So
tell me some of the rhymes. Do you remember them offhand?
Oh, you should just play the song.
I'll play the song. Yeah. Let me play a little segment right here.
I don't know how, I don't know why, but I like ladies and I like guys. I realize it's a surprise, but now I see that that's just me. It's not like I even tried. So if you ask me how I'm doing, here is my reply. I'm getting by, I'm getting by. Oh yeah, I'm letting my bi flag fly. Not gonna hide it, not gonna lie. I'm a bi kind of guy, there's no reason to be shy. Until the day I die.
That was awesome. How did you get that? Were you very excited? Okay, yeah.
So basically, I just write down a bunch of jokes, a bunch of rhymes, a bunch of ideas, and it's all just a big mess on, you know, on a page. And then at that point, it just becomes a crossword puzzle of like making it all
right, make it
kind of fit.
Do you pull up the rhyme dictionary?
Totally.
That's like an indispensable.
Oh, every songwriter, any songwriter that says they don't, is just a liar. Rhyme Zone.
Rhyme Zone
basically wrote every song in America, in the world, English speaking.
You heard it here first. It's all about Rhyme Zone. All right. So you write a song like that, and then you record a demo track of it to play for Rachel and the other producers.
Yeah, I usually like to present something that's pretty far along, just because people don't tend to have that as much imagination with music as they think they have.
Right.
And the other thing is that people, if they do like something, they really fall in love with the first version. And then if you try to change it, it's like, what happened to the, you know, it's like called demoitis.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Demoitis is like, it happens all the time on our show, where the showrunner, Aline Brosh McKenna, if she likes something, she really, really likes it. And then she just wants it to be that first thing that she heard. And it doesn't matter if it was something that you sang into your phone, like anything after that. It's like, well, what happened to, you know?
Oh, really?
Yes.
And why do you try to change it?
One example is Jack Dolgen, who's one of my partners on the show, wrote this great song that he sang it was kind of like a fake Nirvana sort of song, and he sang it into his iPhone.
Yeah.
And it was just like a crappy recording that he made on his iPhone, and it wasn't produced at all. It was just him and acoustic guitar, and Aline just fell in love with it. She's like, I want that rawness. And we're like, yeah, but it was supposed to be Nirvana with like drums, and she's like, but she couldn't let it go.
Yeah, she just couldn't let it go.
There was something magical about his initial
right.
demo. So anyway.
Oh man, demoitis.
Demoitis is a huge thing.
It's a huge thing.
Songwriters. And in the world of like pop music too, there's really no such thing as a demo anymore. I mean, people are so used to the sound of fully produced things. You know, it used to be like Tin Pan Alley days or like Brill Building days. You just come over to the piano. Okay, here's the song.
Right.
We'll get some great players on the session. You know, and now it's like people just want to hear it sounding like the finished thing right away.
Right. You know? So you like presented to them with a pretty like professional.
I mean, unless it's really a song where that doesn't matter. But for that one, getting by, I kind of produced the demo.
You produced it. And do they have notes like on the lyrics? Are they like, oh, we have to change this, we have to change that?
Yeah, sometimes. I mean, that one, they didn't actually have that many notes. There's some songs that get rewritten many, many times. I mean, it's really like a script. But the tricky thing is, you know, with a script, you could just punch up one joke. But with a song, it's like a house of cards.
Because
everything rhymes. So if you change one joke, then you have to change the line that sets it up.
It's Jenga.
Yeah, it really is. It's very... And sometimes when I've worked with, you know, script writers, they don't understand that. And they think that you can just change a line like you can with a script. And I have to politely say, I don't think I can change it. And then I look like I have a bad attitude.
Who are your biggest songwriting influences, you think?
That's interesting. I mean, as a kid, I was a big Beatles freak for, you know, my entire childhood. That was sort of all I listened to for many years. And then as I got older, I listened to all kinds of different stuff, but I did sort of gravitate toward people that wrote songs that actually kind of told stories and make sense. I mean, Randy Newman was actually somebody that I learned about from your dad, but I remember Little Criminals by Randy Newman, which is basically like short stories, you know, and I had never, and part of the thing that was really interesting about Randy Newman is that the person singing the song was like a character.
Yeah.
You know, so it's not that typical songwriting as your diary thing. It's like making up a character and the character is singing you a song. But you're also the narrator is sort of unreliable and weird or racist or something, you know. It's like, so you're learning about the person that's actually singing the song. I thought that was so cool. So I love writing stuff like that that's in somebody else's voice.
That's interesting, because now that I think about it, you do a lot of writing where you're kind of in character, like of obviously what we just heard is an example of it.
Probably the most famous song I've ever written is Stacy's Mom, and that's that. I mean, that's basically like a character singing that song.
So who's singing that song?
Was supposed to be a teenager. I mean, although when they made the music video for it, they ended up casting it as like a 13-year-old. It was very uncomfortable. I told the director, I was like, are you sure this is okay? He's kind of young.
It's like you were thinking more like The Graduate.
I was thinking it was like 17, at least 18. I don't know. But anyway.
I encourage you all to watch that video. That was Rachel Hunter. And it's a classic video. Stacy's Mom.
It was directed by a friend of mine named Chris Applebaum, who I've known for, you know, since we were both in our early 20s, and I'm in my mid 20s now. So that was like two years ago. he started out doing very indie, small budget, cool rock videos, and then morphed into the guy that does like Rihanna and Miley Cyrus. And
right. He's big
he
time.
He did the Paris Hilton Carl's Jr. commercials where Paris Hilton is like eating a cheeseburger very sexy.
Very sexy.
Yeah, so he became that guy. And Stacey's mom was like somewhere in the middle of that transition where he started realizing that
sex sells.
Exactly. Anyway, yeah, but that song was written from the perspective of a character, as are a lot of Fountains of Wayne songs.
Let's listen to that for a sec. Come up with the idea to do a song like that?
Well, funnily enough, our mutual friend Jeremy Freeman inspired that song indirectly because he used to always say that my grandmother was hot, which is true. She was hot. Rose Bernthal, she was very hot. But and I just was laughing about that and thinking about it. It was just at a point when, you know, we were all probably like, you know, I don't know, 12 or something.
Exactly.
But then I started thinking about that as an idea for a song. And I was like, well, grandmother's a little much, but somebody lusting after somebody's mom is sort of funny. And so I had that line. I just thought, well, what's sort of a good all-American name? I thought Stacy, you know, which is actually, I didn't name it after her, but the drummer in Fountains of Wayne's wife at the time was named Stacy.
And did you come up with this? It was the first thing that you thought of, Stacy's mom has got it going on, yeah. Like that lyric?
Yeah, I had that. And then I just started kind of building on it from there. And there was no music. It was just that line. Whenever I was trying to write an album, I would just keep a word processing file with like lots of little snippets of lyric ideas, funny lines, things that I thought had potential. And then I kind of started thinking, well, it would be fun if it was in that sort of Rick Springfield Cars kind of world, like an 80s, because, you know, like Jesse's Girl,
yeah.
My Best Friend's Girl, like what those songs where you're lusting after some girl you can't have, like that's a,
right.
That's
unrequited
a genre.
Love. Yep.
That's a genre from that period. So it seemed like that would just be a funny, different take on that.
It's interesting because that song was one that was written in character. And I think of That Thing You Do, that was totally written because that was actually...
Well, the funny thing about that song, So
Adam wrote the theme song for That Thing You Do, the famous Tom Hanks movie. And the whole movie was called That Thing You Do. The whole movie revolved around this one song and this hit song. Well, it didn't. About this hit song that they write in the 60s, early 60s?
It was supposed to be 1964 and the Beatles have just invaded America and all these American bands are imitating them. So it was supposed to be an American band that was like imitating the Beatles. But that song is not written from the perspective of a character. That song is written for characters in a movie. So it's a slightly different assignment.
Yeah.
You know, the assignment was this should feel like a band in 1964 from Pennsylvania would actually write this to trying to be the Beatles. But the lyric itself was just like a straight ahead kind of pop rock love song kind of lyric or whatever you want to call it. I mean, I think the most important thing for me when I'm writing a song is the assignment. I have to understand what the assignment is. And sometimes there is no assignment. It's just my own assignment. I give myself the assignment. But when I'm being hired to write something, the most important thing is having the information right. You know, and in the case of Tom Hanks, I mean, they were very specific. Like he knew this is the year and here's some references. He mentioned like the Knickerbockers, which was this band from that time and a few other things. So they were very, very focused on what they wanted already. And if I have good information, then I can usually have a good shot at getting it right.
Right.
But there's been other times where I get like misinformation, like third hand from somebody that's not really in charge. Mm-hmm. Like here's a funny example of that. Like one time I got a call that they were looking for some song. I don't remember what movie it was, but some movie. And they were like, it's an aerobics or exercise class, and they want kind of like a Pointer Sisters, like a jump or like Neutron Dance kind of feel for it. And I'm like, okay, cool. So like retro 80s, you know, funny, like high energy. So I did this thing that sounded like the Pointer Sisters, and then I sent it in, and then I got this note back. They're like, they felt that it sounded dated.
You're like,
and
wait.
I was like, but, and then it turned out that what had happened was like, that nobody wanted anything retro at all. It's just the person that gave me the note, that was the only reference they knew.
Yeah.
Really, they just wanted some music playing in a present day like exercise class. But this lame movie executive was like, you know, like Pointer Sisters or something.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That became my assignment and I totally blew it.
Right. But, oh, that's frustrating.
Annoying.
So do people make a living writing just being lyricists?
Yeah, a lot of people. Well, I wouldn't say a lot, but there, you know, I mean, there's a lot of people that do that. And, these days, I think, especially in the world of top 40 pop music, it's really been separated into kind of an assembly line mentality. And it's not really so much, you know, the artist waiting for his muse to strike anymore. It's like there's a bunch of track guys that just make cool tracks.
And what does that mean, track?
Tracks is like, you know, making the beats, making the synth programming. They'll do something that's basically an instrumental hit, but there's no melody on top of it. There's no vocals. And then they'll bring in somebody that might just write a melody but doesn't write the lyrics.
Right.
Or maybe there's somebody that just writes hooks and they just kind of improvise and do a chorus. And then the producers chop that up. And then sometimes there's people that can write the melodies but they can't write lyrics. Sometimes there's people that have great lyric ideas but they're not really melody people. And anyway, so a lot of these hit songs these days have, you know, multiple people credited as writers on them, all of whom had a specific role.
And oftentimes it's just somebody who just does lyrics?
Yeah, like a very good friend of mine, Sam Hollander, he's not only a lyricist, but he's primarily a lyricist. And I think that his main gift is coming up with really good hook ideas. Like he just knows what sticks in people's brains.
What were some that he did?
Well, you know, like recently he wrote this, or co-wrote with Fits in the Tantrums, that song called Hand Clap.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's just like a classic Sam thing because it's just like one hook after another. So,
yeah, let's listen to that for a sec.
Well, let's not listen to Sam's song. This is my podcast.
All right, we're not listening to Sam's song. Sorry, Sam.
Sam, you come and do an interview.
Yeah, I'm going to come and find Sam.
Yeah.
No, is it Sam? I know this is your podcast, but just to understand how it worked.
You're trying to step on my podcast.
Yeah, sorry, man. Just to understand how Sam did Hand Clap. So did he just write the lyrics for that, or did he actually write like the chorus?
I don't really know what the process. I mean, you actually should talk to him about that.
Okay.
But like, there are definitely people that are known primarily as lyric guys. I mean, you know, one of the most famous ones is like Bernie Taupin, who did all of Elton John's songs. I mean, that guy is so lucky because his partner was like Elton John, who could make anything sound amazing. And
right.
So Bernie Taupin's lyrics are
the
paper.
Worst.
But they're just so weird.
I mean, I absolutely love Elton John's music, but there are some lyrics, like for example.
But then again, no.
Yeah, but then again, no. Yeah. I mean, goodbye, Norma Jean. The lyrics are pretty cheesy.
I mean,
all due respect.
Whatever, they work. You know, some of them work really well because they're just abstract and strange. But anyway, yeah, if you have somebody like Elton John that knows how to, or like Squeeze was another example, one of my favorite bands, Glenn Tilbrook and Chris Difford were the songwriting team. And Chris Difford, from what I understand, would just write basically a poem, a lyric, and then Glenn Tilbrook would figure out how to make it into a song. So yeah, there are people that do that. I mean, that's a tough racket, I think, to just be a lyricist.
Yep, it
because,
is.
Because, I mean, part of the weird thing
is, can you be a lyricist without being a musician?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think so. I mean, you can be a songwriter without being a musician. There's a lot of songwriters that can't play any instruments and they sing something and somebody helps.
It's like
them.
Me, yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
I wrote the theme music for my podcast.
Oh, snap. It's pretty good.
I mean, I'm already getting, you know, Grammy. There's a buzz. There's a buzz happening.
I'm feeling it. I've heard it around town a lot.
Founds of Wayne, probably one of your most well-known endeavors, and you've done a lot of endeavors, but Founds of Wayne it's interesting because it has like a real cult following. I found this out when I moved to Los Angeles among writers like Founds of Wayne.
Which is great because writers end up hopefully running TV shows and things where they can use Founds of Wayne music.
and they have, some of them have.
No, well, I mean, I think hopefully that's true because it is a little bit more of a writer's kind of band. I mean, like I was saying, the songs are, I think, you know, there's two songwriters in that band. It's me and Chris Collingwood, and we write differently, but I think in both cases, the writing part of it is sort of important to us. We're not like a band that just gets together and jams and kind of comes up with a riff. I mean, the songs are sort of written to be read as well as heard.
Were you in character when you write Founds of Wayne songs?
I wouldn't say I'm in character, but I have to always know who's going to be singing the song. And that informs what I write. Like with Chris, who was the lead singer in Fountains Wayne, I had to think about what he would be willing to sing or what would sound good with him singing it. And even when I tried to do that, there would be times where he would just veto stuff. Like he just didn't feel comfortable singing it or something. So we would fight all
the time. What was like a lyric that he wouldn't sing?
There were so many. I mean, you know, but that, I mean, I understand that, you know, he has to be the guy that's up there and it's coming out of his mouth. And so people kind of assume he wrote it. He was never totally comfortable being in that sort of like role of like the voice of someone else's song.
So lyrically, what's one of the songs you're most proud of from Fountains of Wayne?
Well, you know, weirdly, there's this song called All Kinds of Time that's on, we had a record called Welcome Interstate Managers that was our biggest record, actually. But that was a song that it started out as just, I heard that phrase. It's a sports phrase from football games where they're like, and he's got all kinds of time. You know, yeah. Like he's, you know, the quarterback has a lot of pass protection. So he's got time to look for a good open man. And I thought about what a weird phrase that was. And I had this idea of like, what if you took that really literally and like extended this, that moment to be the length of a whole song of just the quarterback kind of getting into his like, perfect Zen kind of frame of mind. And it's like time slows down. And it's like those NFL films where it's like suddenly everything's slow motion. And when I had this idea and I thought it was kind of a silly idea, like a football song, like who cares, you know, but it was more just like something I thought was a little funny. But when I ended up finishing that song, it, for me at least, it was weirdly like moving. It was like much more of a deep emotional experience than I expected. And a lot of people have said that, like that song is like weirdly has power that it doesn't really make sense to have in like a football song. I don't know. I don't mean to be like tooting my own horn about it, but it's just the point. It's like, you don't know which songs are going to suddenly have more effect on it.
Totally.
And I feel like that was a very abstract idea that came together better than I could have hoped.
Well, let's let the audience decide whether you're tooting your own
like
horn.
Smash or trash.
Here we go. You let me know in the comments. I'm going to play a little piece of it here.
Running down, the team's losing ground to the opposing defense. The young quarterback waits for the snap when suddenly it all starts to make sense. He's got all kinds of time, he's got all kinds of time. All kinds of time. He's got all kinds of time. All kinds of time.
He takes a step. I noticed that you, a lot of times, okay, so you talked about sometimes you adopt a character. But you also adapt a genre, like you, because you're really good. People bring you on a lot, I feel like, to create a certain, like if they've written a song or they want a song to be in a certain genre, they'll hire you because you're very good at adapting. You're very good at writing different.
Chameleon.
You're a good chameleon. Sorry, I didn't want to say that.
No,
word.
It's true, and it's funny because you know one of the big breakthroughs in my life. I don't know, when I was like in college and in my early 20s, and I was really feeling pressure to like figure out what my musical identity was. And it was really hard because I love all kinds of different music. I mean, some more than others, but I have very wide ranging tastes and I wanted to be authentic, but I didn't really know what my authentic musical style was. And all musicians, you know, especially like pop musicians and rock musicians, they kind of have to identify themselves. They have to pick a lane and sort of be that.
Right.
You know, it's like Bob Dylan invented being Bob Dylan, but that was a choice, mm-hmm. you know, and it's like Paul Simon invented being Paul Simon because there was already the Beatles and he's like, well, what can I be that's a little different? So everybody's looking for their thing. And I was having a really hard time trying to figure out like what I really wanted to do. And then I had this revelation that I can be the guy that can imitate all these different styles, which is like, that's my niche.
Good at that.
It's like a niche onto itself. Cause like if somebody calls me up and says, you know, I want like an early 90s hip hop track, I could probably figure out a way to approximate. It's not gonna be the greatest one ever made. I mean, I'm not like Premiere, but I could figure out a way to fake that. But then if somebody says we want a Cole Porter song,
I can do that too.
Cause I have enough musical training. So it's like that became in a weird way, my,
it's not only new musical training, you just also have, I feel like you have a little bit of an encyclopedic mind when it comes to different music, different genres, different songs.
Well, you have to know a lot of them. And the ones that you don't know, you have to figure out. I mean, I remember your dad, we should mention your dad is a very well-known film composer and one of my heroes in life, Michael Small. And I remember him telling me, I think it was some movie that he was working on where he had to imitate, I don't even remember what world music it was, but the music of some country that he didn't know anything about. But he just kind of explained to me how, well, you know, you just go listen to a lot of it and, you know, you kind of pick up little characteristics about it. And then you figure out a way to do a version of it. It doesn't mean you're going to be like the greatest artist in that genre, but you learn how to listen for certain things that will make it work. And I get assignments all the time where I don't really know the genre. So I go and do sort of research and listen to a lot of stuff. And I learn to pick up, okay, what are the drums sound like? What are the chord changes that they kind of use? Are they like jazzy and complicated? Or are they really simple, basic ones? And what kind of rhythms are you know, and you pick up these little bits of information and then try to do your own little take on it.
I mean, it's interesting because writing is that way too. Like if I get an assignment to write for, I don't know, Ladies Home Journal.
Right.
You know, I will pick up an issue and read
You're
through
not
a bunch
be
of
like, Dear Penthouse Forum.
Yeah.
I never thought I'd be writing.
Yeah, I never. It's funny because I think people will start writing for different publications and they won't even have read that publication. You know, you get into it. I feel like you get into the flow. If I was writing for the New Yorker has a very specific, especially the front of the book, like Talk of the Town, it's a very specific voice.
Right, totally.
You know, and not everybody has that voice naturally. And so you have to adapt it. So I think, it's interesting. That the same goes do you think there's any music that you've done that's just, this is Adam, this is not Adam imitating, this is Adam?
I would say probably the things that I do with the bands that I've been in are probably in different places than most, just purely what I, you know, if I had to just pick one thing, like I gravitate toward the sort of power poppy guitar based Beatlesque sort of stuff. I mean, if I just sit down and pick up a guitar, that's the way I kind of start playing automatically. I can do other things, but that's sort of a sweet spot for me. And even with the band Ivy, even though it was a very different kind of band and had a female singer, a French singer, I think there's a lot of the same roots in the music, sort of 60s pop.
Right, you gravitate towards that.
Yeah, I think so.
Is it because it was one of your earliest memories of listening to Beatles?
I think that had a lot to do with it. And I always was interested in melody more than anything else. And that period of music was very melodic. Mm-hmm. You know, it's part of the reason for me that I always liked the Beatles more than like the Stones or Dylan or Springsteen or something. All those artists are amazing, but they're not really so melodic.
Right.
You know, it's just like, it's a vibe or it's the lyrics or it's the attitude, but they never did anything melodically like the Beatles did.
Who is a better lyricist, Paul or John?
Oh, well,
sorry.
But you know, they were so different, but I think they influenced each other as time went on. And that was what was cool about it. I mean, John's lyrics got much weirder maybe, but then you can hear times when Paul started to try to do that and vice versa. Like Paul seemed like more like the craftsman or something. Like his stuff was more like traditionally organized, but then John could do that too if he wanted to. So
what's one of your favorite Beatles songs? Just as far as like a perfect composition of like lyrics and melody. And I mean, there's so many good ones.
I know, man, it's always impossible.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah. I mean, my favorite Beatles album is weirdly probably the White Album, just because I always liked how it just seemed like they were trying anything they wanted to try. And they weren't worried about the album sounding like one thing from beginning to end. It was like total rockers and total intimate ballads and everything in between and every genre.
That's true.
That was very freeing. The fact that it still sounded like the Beatles. It all sounded
right.
Like the Beatles.
And talk about like adapting different personas. And like, I mean, Rocky Raccoon is on that.
Yeah.
But they also have Helter Skelter.
I love
Rocky Raccoon.
I'm not objective about Beatles songs at all. I love all of them. Like even the supposed bad ones that are not bad.
Even the really early ones, like from the early 60s.
I love this. I mean, they were like a cool, like raw, almost like garage band at the beginning, you know?
Yeah.
They made those first records by just going in and playing all those songs and leaving.
Yeah.
You know, I was like, how was that? Okay, I think we got it.
We got it.
First Beatles album.
So if I'm a young lyricist,
yeah,
what advice would you give somebody kind of just starting out in the game?
If your goal is to write specifically lyrics, and I don't know,
yeah.
That's a tough one. I mean, I think that, well, obviously, first of all, if you're only a lyricist, you need to try to connect with good musicians because your songs are only going to be good as good as the music. So make some connections. Find your Elton John. If you want to be Bernie Taupin, And the music business, even the people that are very successful write way, way more stuff than is ever heard. You know, even people that have hit songs, they probably for every hit they have, you know, 99 that nobody's heard.
Yeah.
And they get known for two or three in their whole career. I mean, that's what happens. But it's also, you know, lyrics are a slightly different thing than just being a writer. It's a different set of skills and people absorb them differently. People tend to hear music non-intellectually at first, and then they go back and get into the lyrics after repeated listens. But the first thing is just kind of how it sounds. And they don't always work as poetry, and they don't always work as like linear stories. It, you know, you get a sense for it. I mean, I wrote a song recently with Michael Chabon, the author, you know, who mm-hmm. happens to also be a really good lyricist.
That's so interesting.
Because he's, you know, he understands.
So Michael Chabon wrote.
Well, Moon Glow was a recent one, and Telegraph Avenue, and Cavalier and Clay.
Cavalier and Clay.
Yeah, and, you know, he's like a
huge
Pulitzer Prize winner.
Yeah. Okay.
So he's up and coming. You know?
Yeah. He's just a struggling guy.
I see big things for him. But anyway, no, he and I wrote a song together. And
now tell me how that came about.
We actually became friends on Instagram because he's like very into Instagram. And I produced this record for the Monkees about a year and a half ago. And he really liked the Monkees record and was like liking things on there. And then I sort of hit him up and said, hey, cool. And I like your books. And, you know, we should meet one day. We should do something. So we ended up meeting and just hitting it off. And I said, well, I'm working on this Monkees Christmas record, which it turned out got pushed and is not happening yet, but will hopefully happen. Anyway, I said, if you have an idea for a lyric for Monkees Christmas song, let me know. And he sent me one like, I think like one day later, like he got very into it.
Yeah.
It's just because I think it's just like a fun, quick assignment.
You know, he's never
done
before.
If you're used to writing like 600 page books,
yeah.
It's probably fun to go write like two paragraphs of
lyrics.
But
you know what? It's hard too.
It is hard. It's really hard. But he came up with a really cool idea and sent it to me and I loved it. And I got, you know, it took me a minute to make a demo and get it back to him, but it's a good song. So hopefully it'll see the light of day. But that's the thing is he's super smart because he knows the difference between a lyric and a book, you know, and that it's really just, it's so much about how it sings and how it sounds as much as what it means.
But it's interesting because I think a lot of people would think writing lyrics is easy. Like, oh, you just have to rhyme things like da, 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 da. But a lot of lyrics aren't really about anything, but they're cool lyrics. Like I think of so many songs I listen to where like, I'm like, what are they talking
about? I know.
About?
And it's such a weird mix of like the voice and the sound of the words and the meaning. And like, it's really like, there's no right or wrong. It's just some people hit on these magical combinations where it all comes together.
What's a song that I can play that is like, the lyrics are very kind of obscure and don't have any, not linear and don't have any meaning, but.
I don't know, like Crimson and Clover, you know that song?
Yeah.
Like, what is that song about? But it's one of my favorite songs.
I don't even know what Crimson and Clover
just
means.
Just had that phrase. I think that Tommy James just had that phrase, and it's just like, that's a cool phrase.
Yeah, like what is it? Yeah. I don't even know what Crimson and Clover refers to.
I don't know. There's a lot of
songs
like that that are just like, I mean, a lot of Beatles songs are kind of like that too. You don't really know what they're talking about, but it just, you know, I mean, even like there's some lines in like Hey Jude where it's like, the movement you need is on your shoulder.
Yeah.
Like, what?
<You know? laughs> Right. But it just sounds
or,
cool.
Or, you know, one of my favorite songs of all time is Once in a Lifetime by the Talking Heads. And that's so cool to me because that's like that was a giant hit that's like been popular for like forever.
And you may find yourself living in a shotgun shack. And you may find yourself in another part of the world. And you may find yourself behind the wheel of a large automobile. And you may find yourself in a beautiful house with a beautiful wife. And you may ask yourself, well, how did I get here?
And it's not that it doesn't mean anything, but it's very impressionistic and strange, and it's a very sort of dreamlike song.
I always heard that he had heard that that he had been listening to the radio and he heard a preacher really late, like late at night saying, and you might think, you know, that, and he just kind of like used it. Like,
oh,
but I don't know.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
And then, and the way that works with the chorus is brilliant. And I think if you can come up with a song like that, that is very abstract and unusual, but also a hit, that's the coolest thing.
Right.
You know, where everyone's walking around singing it, they don't even think about it. Like, whoa, this is, what am I singing? I don't even know.
So we've talked about Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. We've talked about Fountains of Wayne. We've talked about That Thing You Do, Ivy.
Yeah.
One of the things that you also do is you write musicals. You're working. You've written one.
I've written one musical. I'm writing another musical now with Sarah Silverman and a guy named Josh Harmon, which is based on Sarah Silverman's book called The Bedwetter, and we're pretty close to having at least the first full draft of it with all the songs written. But I like, in general, musical theater, and it's very much sort of related to the other kinds of stuff I do.
How so?
Well, I mean, just in terms of the combination of the musical part of it and having to tell stories and having to really like move the story, you know, songs and musicals have to move the story along. That's what they always say. You can't stop the show. So, you know, it's you really are very much collaborating with the book writer and sort of trading off. And some things start off as lyrics and then they end up as dialogue and vice versa. Sometimes there's dialogue and I'll say like, well, what, can't he just sing this? Can't this whole be a song right here?
So it's very hard. So you can't really, you have to work in concert with the...
Yeah, it's super collaborative. And the boundaries between everybody's roles are a little blurry. Like some of these songs that I'm writing with Sarah, I mean, I'm writing the whole lyric, but the whole thing started from some joke in her book. So it's like, you know, I take a joke that's already in there and then I like musicalize it and expand on it or something.
So tell me about that. I don't know how much you can tell me about the process of working with Sarah, but... You know, you've read through her book, you sort of highlight things that you thought funny, like moments and...
Yeah, I mean, I actually pitched her on the whole idea of doing a musical about it because I had worked with her a little bit, but I read her book and I was looking, you know, everybody's trying to turn every movie into a Broadway show. And I get calls about that, like, hey, do you want to do the, you know, Logan's Run or I don't know, whatever, yes, just anything, right. You know, well, like, which would be kind of a dope one, actually.
That's a good one.
I know, but whatever it is, you know,
it's true
that everybody that owns the rights to any movie is sort of like, yeah, why not? Let's see if it works as a musical and I can make more money off of it.
Groundhog
but
Day.
I wanted to try to find some kind of source material that wasn't a movie because I feel like people are starting to burn out on that a little bit.
Yep.
And I love Sarah and I loved her book. And I went to her and I said, I feel like these childhood chapters of this book could be musicalized and we could either use it as is, or we can fictionalize it a little bit, but just the tone of a kid version of you is very interesting to me. I think, you know, like a show with a little 10-year-old Sarah Silverman would be funny.
Plus it has a good name.
Yeah, it has a good name and the book's hilarious. So it took us a long time to get a story together. And now I think we finally have a good story. We went through several different collaborators.
What do you mean you went through collaborators?
Well, you know, she at first she thought she wanted to write the book herself. By the book, I mean the script. Mm-hmm. And then she decided, you know what, I really want to work in tandem with somebody that's done this before because she's never written a musical. So we had a few different people try to do it and mostly for non-creative reasons, like they just got too busy or other things that it just didn't pan out. And so we kept having to start over. And now we're working with this guy, Josh Harmon, who's been great. And now it's finally turning into something.
And what does somebody like a Josh Harmon bring to it? Like he understands.
I mean, he's a playwright.
You know? Right.
He's like a real playwright. Like he knows how to craft story and he knows what works on a stage and he knows, a real like theater
person.
That's
the script.
Yeah. And he also happens to be a big fan of Sarah's and is funny and his plays are really funny and smart, but he can also kind of step back and be like, all right, this is going to be pretty much in Sarah Silverman's voice and I'm going to help her get there.
Is Sarah helping at all with the writing of the lyrics to her songs?
Well, our process in that instance has been that we'll get together and talk about a song slot and I'll just kind of record our conversation and we'll kick it around and what should this song be about? And she'll throw out joke ideas and we'll throw out line ideas. And then I'll just go home with a big mess of stuff to wade through. And then I'll try to turn it into a song. So sometimes she's given me stuff that it becomes a verbatim lyric. And other times it's like she just points in a direction.
Right.
But I mean, she also writes songs, and she's written a lot of songs just in her own comedy. And
that's
stuff.
True. Like some of them,
right?
And I, not appropriate for this family podcast,
right? This fucking family podcast,
son of a.
But no, I just did another song with her for her television show called "I Love You, America," and that song she wrote all the lyrics. And,
okay,
and not all, but like. You know, 90%. I threw in a couple of things, but she had the idea for the song and she knew she wanted it to be kind of a you know, like a Springsteen, Mellencamp, kind of like Born in the USA sort of thing. And she kind of had the whole idea already, and I just helped her musicalize it.
So you also write a lot of songs for award shows. And I want you to talk to me about that. Like, you've written for Stephen Colbert. You've written stuff for Neil Patrick Harris when he opens up the Emmys. And
The Stephen Colbert stuff was not award show stuff. I worked on Stephen Colbert's show. We did a Christmas special. I wrote songs with a guy named David Javerbaum that I also wrote the Broadway show Crybaby with. And I've worked on a lot of stuff with him. But I did for a while get into this weird niche of doing award show opening numbers and numbers in the middle and numbers at the end.
Why do you think that is that you got into that?
It's the same sort of thing where it's a very specific songwriting assignment that needs to do a specific thing. DJ and I, David Javerbaum and I did the Tonys twice with Neil Patrick Harris, and those went really well, especially the first time we did it. We did a song called Broadway Is Not Just for Gays Anymore, which you know, went over incredibly well, and it was amazing. And
let's listen to a little part of that right now.
If you've seen a show, then you already know how magical theater can be. It's a two-hour live-action, barely affordable, unlip-synced version of Glee. So this song goes out to the rest of you, those who've never seen theater before. Because Broadway has never been broader. It's not just for gays anymore. If you feel like someone that this world excludes, it's no longer only for dudes who like dudes. Attention, every reader, you're invited to the theater. It's not just for gays anymore. The glamour of Broadway is beckoning straights, the people who marry in all 50 states. We're asking every hetero to get to know us better. Oh, it's not just for gays anymore.
So that was hilarious. Where was the genesis of that song?
I give full credit to David Javerbaum for coming up with that idea. He wrote the lion's share of the lyric. I helped him and threw in some lines, and I wrote the music. But you know, looking for something edgy and fun, but also that can be on broadcast TV. I think we pitched him, as I recall, you know, we pitched him that, and he was immediately just like, oh yeah.
Yeah. That's like a winner from the second.
That's a no brainer. And the funny thing with Neil is that he's, you know, he's got these like nerves of steel. He can go on live television and do anything. And he actually, after the first draft of that song was handed in as a demo, he wanted it to be even harder to pull off. Like, there's this whole long run in the middle, just like rapid fire lyrics, and he's singing it while he's being spun around over, you know, like a bunch of dancers are picking him up and flipping him around. It's just unbelievable. It's like the circus, but he stays, he has three costume changes within the number. So
he actually encouraged you, like, I want this to be more difficult.
Yeah. Like he wants to really be pushed to like pull off something incredible so that at the end of it, people are just like, holy shit. And you are, when you watch it, it's kind of cute because there's this whole, you know, the whole elaborate song he pulls off without a hitch. And then the one thing that went wrong was there's this part where he goes into the audience and the different celebrities that were there were given a few lines, mm-hmm. and like Brooke Shields just totally choked. It was kind of cute. Like everybody got their part. And then Brooke Shields just, she had to like keep starting over, and she's like reading off the cue cards. And so it was like embarrassing for Brooke Shields.
Poor Brooke Shields.
I know.
Not really known as a performing artist in that way.
I'd be terrified, but it's just so funny. Cause like Neil does this incredible thing. And, you know,
yeah. And then it's like she had
line.
She just couldn't do it.
It's scary. It's live TV. It's the Tonys.
And working with Stephen Colbert. So he's just obviously a genius. Did you work on the lyrics with him as well? Or was that again?
The lyrics that we did 9 songs, lyrics were mostly written by David Jarabam on that one. I threw in some stuff here and there, but the whole project was something that he came up with. And so I was the music producer in this, and that wrote a lot of wrote all the music and threw in, you know, a little bit here and there on the lyrics, as I recall. But yeah, the awards show thing. So that sort of led to, I did some stuff for the Emmys one year. We did a song called "The Number" in the middle of the show because they wanted to just pick up the energy. It's a long award show, so we did that. I did an opening song for the Billboard Music Awards, which was a weird bunch of people. It was Ken Jeong, the comedian, actor, and Pat
from The Hangover,
Monahan from the band Train, and Nicki Minaj. So that was a funny group of people collaborating on something together.
And that's fun.
One of my actual like proudest moments is I had a little text fight with Nicki Minaj.
Which really?
It's not in my phone anymore. I'm so sad.
Oh man.
But we were sort of having a little debate about like something having to do with the playback or something. I don't even really remember, but I was just like, I'm so happy that Nicki Minaj is yelling at me.
She was mad at you? She cared enough.
Yeah, she was into it. I mean, she did great, but anyway, she wasn't mad, but it was like down to the wire. It was like 10 minutes before we went on, and, you know. but yeah, so, and I've worked on a few other award show things, and that's like, we just did, Rachel Bloom and I and Jack Dolgen did a little song for the Emmys this year called, The Best Part of the Show. And it was just a thing for when they bring on the accountants.
Yeah, that was funny. I remember that.
Cute little number.
Was that your idea?
Kind of. I mean, the basic idea.
I'll just take credit for it. Damn it.
Well, I mean, we mutually were like, what can we say about the accountants that's fun? And then we just sort of landed on the simplest thing. Like, this is the best part of the show. Like, that's, you know.
Right.
It's just kind of a bouncy little number.
Adam, I want you to take me out of this podcast with one of your great song from your canon.
Take me out with one. How about here's a good one for you.
Yeah.
So I worked on a movie called Music and Lyrics.
It was a
movie directed by a guy named Mark Lawrence, a friend of mine, and it's about a songwriter
played by Hugh Grant.
Hugh Grant is sort of a washed up 80s pop star who's kind of making his living at this point playing like county fairs and anyway, the basis of the plot is that he sort of has a shot at a comeback, and he ends up collaborating with Drew Barrymore, and she's a lyricist, and they end up working together, and then at the end, and then of course there's a romance, and then at the end of the movie, he writes a song for her because she's given up on him, and so he writes this song for her called "Don't Write Me Off," and he sings it at the piano at this big concert scene at the end of the movie, and it's actually his character's voice singing to Drew Barrymore's character. So maybe that's a good one for this.
All right.
Don't Write Me Off.
Don't Write Me Off. Right about now, thank you, Adam Schlesinger, for joining.
Thank you, John Small.
You're welcome. I bring you now...
Don't Write Me Off.
Easy for me to find words to go along with a melody, but this time there's actually something on my mind, so please forgive these few brief awkward lines. Since I met you, my whole life has changed. It's not just my furniture you've rearranged. I was living in the past, but somehow you've brought me back, and I haven't felt like this since before Frankie said relax. And though I know, based on my track record, I might not seem like the safest bet, all I'm asking you is don't write me off just yet. For years I've been telling myself the same old story, that I'm happy to live off my so-called former glories. But you've given me a reason to take another chance. Now I need you, despite the fact that you've killed all my plans. And though I know I've already blown more chances than anyone should ever get, all I'm asking you is don't write me off just yet. Don't write me off just yet.